How high a VO2 max would I like an athlete to have or an individual to have? Look at the flip side of this. I'll give you the answer. I want a VO2 max as high as will support an increase in work capacity across broad time and modal domains. This is true of strength. It's true of flexibility. Hell, we are measuring power. Speed is a correlate also here, and not a first-order concern. Okay, questions about that? Yeah. So, now this is interesting. We have had considerable interaction with communities where lactate threshold, onset blood lactate, VO2 max, stuff done on force plates, all these kinds of things, are first-order concerns, where these things are being measured and used to assess athletic capacity. Here's what we found. By working to increase work capacity across broad time and modal domains, we have bested those tests after years of, this is what happened at USA Skiing. So they sent us some athletes, and we're like, fine, what we're going to do is we're going to test them by working them out with our other athletes and find out what they suck at and what they're good at, and try and bring them to a par with our best athletes, just on a level playing field in terms of their capacity, in terms of these various exercises. And what happened is when they went back into the laboratory, we found that these correlates, like onset blood lactate and VO2 max and strength, had been maximized over, in many cases, significant periods of testing. But worked this thing, and kept playing with it. Now, I told you we had these three models, that were these clumsy operational models, and it was accompanied with another piece that was at first a curious observation. We weren't sure if it's significant. We couldn't shake it. We didn't know if it was a fourth model of fitness or something that would later show to have other significance to us. And that is that we had observed that there was a continuum on which I could order just about any metric that was of value to a physician or an exercise physiologist, and we found that these things were well ordered between pathological values, normal or healthy with quotes values, and the values that you'd find consistent with athletes. And I could do this with bone density, with body fat, resting heart rate. Are you following me? So if you've got a resting heart rate of 100, your doctor may be concerned about that, probably should be concerned about it. 70 would be normal. Lots of CrossFitters with a resting heart rate about 35 or 40. We can do this with percent body fat. We can do this with HGA1C, triglycerides, good cholesterol, bad cholesterol. In fact, we do not know of a marker. I do not know of a metric, whether it's something from a subjective assessment, in fact, like mood function, or whether it's objective measure, we don't know of a significant counter to this, where that we don't have values of the fit sitting on opposite side of well from values of those that were pathological. This suggested to us very powerfully that fitness and wellness, or fitness and health, were related, that they were differing measures of the same reality. Okay, certainly that there was some dependence, without a doubt. And it was interesting that we met almost immediately with criticism there, and chiefly and quickly from Mel Siff, who just took just huge exception to this notion that I would say that there was something wrong with his fitness because of his health challenges. And it was sad to see that his nutritional paradigm was heavily atherogenic, that it was responsible for the coronary heart disease that killed him. And people can talk about genetics all day long, but the truth is that he had a genetic low tolerance to hyperinsulinism and excessive carbohydrate consumption. That's what happened to Mel Siff. And he never was really able to come to terms with it, and I think in no small part, and I have immense respect for the late Dr. Siff. He was a hugely formative, his Facts and Fallacies of Fitness is one of the few books out of the academic community that I haven't thrown away. Sorry about that, but kept on the shelf. And but he had a problem in that he couldn't see that these things might be related, fitness and health. They were entirely different things for him. Because he was a very capable performer, so he thought, and because he was in ill health, he thought they were different things, and there couldn't be any correlation between the two. But we kept looking at that. We kept looking at it. And what happened in the end was that we took on this graph here where I have power output on the y-axis on the ordinate, and in the abscissa or x-axis I have the time in minutes. And there we go. What we did was brought out a third axis of age, which you'll see there in years. And we took this work capacity and we looked at it over a period of a lifetime and asked ourselves, geez, what does that volume under the curve, what might it suggest? What would it show? Well, it is what it is. It is a graph of your work capacity across broad time and modal domains. That is your power output marked across the duration of effort in minutes. But I add another piece here, an age, and I develop a three-dimensional solid that is very, very real stuff that can readily be measured. What you call that measure is entirely up to you, but I want to suggest that it gives us a quantifiable, reasonably accurate, and precise metric for what is commonly referred to as health. And I think that this is better than the one of the standard definitions of health, which is just the absence of disease. And I think I can play the same game here that we play in the two-dimensional model, that I tell you that I don't care about lactate threshold, I don't care about VO2 max, I don't really care about your strength. What I want to know is your work capacity measured across broad time and modal domains. Well, here in the three space, I would tell you that rather than being so concerned about whether I have heart disease or not, or elevated cholesterol or not, what I'd like to know is what is your work capacity at your current age and how does that measure against others? And so that we could find ourselves in a situation where, say, we have a guy who's 90 years old, he's able to run up and down stairs with a good-sized load in his hands. If you try to jack him up at the ATM, he's going to knock you to the ground and put his foot in your throat, and he's fully functional in every respect, you know, with grandma at home, and just everything works, all right? You guys got physical capacity. What sense would it make to talk about him being in poor health? Could you see, yeah, but he's got high cholesterol. Well, that's the kind of high cholesterol I'd like to have, right? So, suppose his blood pressure were high. Now, where would those things have importance to us? Elevated cholesterol or that he's hypertensive? Or has a markedly elevated HGA1C. Why would that be significant? Well, it would be significant to me only to the extent that it would presage a diminished work capacity next year or tomorrow. But otherwise, not at all. And I want to suggest this to you. I think there is probably more opportunity to, and there's a, Dr. Kilgore points out, there's a quality of life issue here that's not really subtle, but I would like to suggest to you that there, I think, the reality may very well be that there is greater potency, greater opportunity to improve these other metrics like HGA1C, triglycerides, blood pressure, cholesterol by maintaining an elevated work capacity than there is to work these things as individual components and try and get back to a quality of living or a state of health that you would admire. And I'm not alone in that assessment. Theodore Dalrymple, who's a editor for the Wall Street Journal, a British physician, has written several books and a very prolific writer. He, in an article in the Wall Street Journal years ago, and this had really struck me, had said that modern medicine could take very little claim for the advances in life expectancy over the past several hundred years. And he says that most of this was due to sanitation and hygiene. And he said that the next frontier in medicine to push longevity, and it came on the heels of his noting through the literature, that centenarians were remarkably healthy individuals, and yet they only had a 2.5-year life expectancy. And so they would go from remarkably healthy individuals to dead in 2.5 years. And so they had this accelerated and sudden demise. And you don't have to be too creative, though it may be hard to swallow, realize that's probably a best case scenario. And I think I've stated over and over again in our lectures that I've got this fear that modern medicine is going to get us all to live to be 150, but you still go to the nursing home at 75, so you have 75 years of watching Oprah and someone wiping your butt and feeding you Jell-O on a spoon, you know? And it's really, really not the way I want to go out. But Dalrymple had said that the real opportunity for the next big push in medicine would come out of exercise, out of physical activity, and not out of pharmaceutical intervention, nor out of surgery. And I think that's perfectly consistent with this view here that if I can keep my work capacity high, these other things that we're traditionally looking at and traditionally concerned about as being so critical to our health are largely weak correlates with limited predictive value to where it is that you want to be, which is what? Fully capable at 90, no? Is this resonating with you? And so look at this process here. So we you know, left to our own devices, we define these terms for our own use. Then we, through careful observation and measurement and just staring at the data, we look at this thing until we finally come up to refined definitions. And you can accept these definitions or reject them. I mean, definitions don't really come in flavors right or wrong. You can just be consistent or inconsistent. Is that right, Dr. Mullis? Yeah. We just want to be consistent with them. But we do have stuff here that can be talked about. And what I mean is that we can make meaningful assertions about this kind of data as these charts and graphs are fleshed out that allow us to speak about effect, about efficiency, about safety, and put us on solid ground where we have defined our terms and are measuring our work. And this is what CrossFit does. This is what we're about as much as anything else. I'm going to add another component here just in terms of full disclosure because I think it's critical. We have exacted record outputs at varying durations of effort, in no small part because we have presented the challenge, the effort as sport. We have presented it as sport. So this is not, you know, though it is an experiment, and every workout, by the way, is a data point. I can at any workout, just almost any workout we do, most of them, the overwhelming majority of them, derive some number of foot-pounds per minute of output over so many minutes for an individual. We can do that. It also bears mentioning here that in the workouts where we cannot, and to the extent that there are errors in our measurements, so this estimating of the center of mass, for instance, it sits somewhere between umbilicus and pubic bone. But the truth is if I'm wildly off in that measurement and I got it up here, it doesn't really affect the amount of travel for most of our movements. So that what you'll find is your center of mass and your nose move identical amounts in a pull-up and in a squat. So even where then the arms may be doing something different, each is just an air squat, not a back squat or a front squat, and where the arm movement may be erratic and inconsistent, as long as the approach of the athlete isn't changed dramatically, what this is zero order error that just cancels out when you're starting to look at the power differential. I mean, it just disappears quite conveniently. But this is the kind of work we're doing. And a lot of it is not seen by the public, even in the scientific community, because it looks like sport, because it looks like game, because it is fun, because it sounds like do Fran and post your time to comments. But we've got a wonderful and growing database on human output across broad time and modal domains, and have left this open as a challenge to all comers, to any community, to do one of several things. One is put your 2 cents in, throw your athlete up there, and show us how it is, what technology you've developed that would get you more foot-pounds per minute over 3, 5, 10 minutes, an hour, 2 hours, and or offer a different standard. Tell us that this doesn't matter at all what you're really measuring. This does. Give me some alternative criteria. And what we've found, very interestingly, is that there have been no offerings, really. Some out of the Canadian forces, the Naval Special Warfare had some stuff they want us to look at. But what we were able to do with the CrossFit athletes is best those other concepts by their own conceptual framework. And so there really wasn't much need to go beyond that in terms of doing what we do, which is what we're trying to advance the technology of human performance, of optimizing human performance. Any questions? Let me share with you just some kind of empirical, maybe untested, other than our sense of what's clinical, like just, you know, garnering market share. I've got some, here's what we know about CrossFit GPP sport training and athletic development. I think it'll answer this question. GPP is the most underdeveloped and neglected aspect of athletic training, especially in elite athletes. Okay, I got a list of these. CrossFit produces an unmatched GPP in novice, intermediate, and advanced athletes regardless of their prior training and sport. Now I'm going to zero in more here. Every athlete we've worked with, from Olympic medalists to UFC legends, has some glaring chink in his, her GPP, and it takes at most 2 hours, two sessions on average to find these chinks. Fixing these chinks, these deficiencies, and here's your answer, has immediate benefit within your sport and very often in ways not quite obvious mechanically and perhaps metabolically. For instance, more pull-ups makes for better skiing and skiers. And I don't know why, and we debate this, discuss it. We've all got kinds of conjecture and hypotheses as to why. But fundamentally, from our point of view, we don't care quite so much, right? Upper body pushing movements make for better rowing and rowers, and anaerobic training is a boon to endurance athletes. And my final point on this, and I am going to backfill, sport training and physiology are not so well understood that highly specialized strength conditioning routines are optimally effective. That would be my answer why. Okay? There's greater margin for improving performance in elite athletes where the margins of victory are very, very tight. Improving GPP with CrossFit can be garnered through additional sport-specific strength conditioning training. And these are the assumptions that we're working on and with the athletes that have come forward. CrossFit produces a ready state from which more advanced or sport-specific training becomes very efficient. That was from the alpinist Mark Twight of Jim Jones fame. CrossFit will, for many sports, reduce the total training volume, that is the strength and conditioning side of it, right? Or the total training volume, including their skills and drills endemic inherent to the sport. Reduce training injuries and allow for more time for vital sport-specific skills and drills. CrossFit is more fun and seems more athletic to experienced athletes than does traditional GPP. And CrossFit has athletes improving their fitness for years beyond a level significantly beyond traditional GPP. By the way, almost regardless of your starting point, our observations, and this is about a 10-year window of adaptation. If you come to me at 55, I'd like to know, have you squatted, had you deadlift, have you cleaned, can you do kipping pull-ups, do you know the snatch, do you know the jerk, have you worked in mixed modalities under a clock? And if your answer is no to all of that, and it very likely would be, then what I'm going to tell you is at 65, you're going to be fitter by every metric we can find than you are at 55. So I've got a 10-year window of adaptation there. And
what about
same thing. I can guarantee it. Now, I'm probably sitting with someone here who has had significant exposure to much of this, so much of this would be blunted. But you'd be amazed out in the real world how few people, especially at 55, have seen any of those exercises. And then again, sport training and physiology are not so well understood that highly specialized strength and conditioning routines are optimally effective. Now, let me share something with you. I said that we were starting with this belief in fitness, that there was an acquired adaptation that would lend itself generally well to any activity. And we put these WADs out, and I don't have workouts for jiu-jitsu and workouts for basketball and workouts for lacrosse and workouts for alpinists and cyclists. But what we have seen is from the highest levels of achievement at the most elite levels, and whether you're talking about Super Bowl rings or multiple gold medals, we've seen every stripe of athlete you can imagine delineated by achievement. They're coming forward in all sports and at a rapid rate, to the extent that right now, and I refer to combat as a sport, I think we have forever altered the face of TAC ops and spec ops training in the military and law enforcement. This new super sport of MMA, mixed martial arts, you're familiar with it? We have athletes in every fight, almost always on every card, and very often both fighters on the card will be ours. We have changed the way rugby is trained forever. We're making our way through the NFL at just a breathtaking pace right now. I know New Zealand All Black is a big CrossFit house. We're often the very last to find out what the impact has been, and we've done no special outreach really to any of these communities, but they are coming forward and in increasing number, growing just like the rest of what we're doing here. And I think that is, at least from the industry perspective, a substantiation of this notion that there is a general physical capacity, acquired physical capacity, that lends itself generally well to all activities. And these people all come back with the same story, that they're a whole lot fitter than they were before doing what they used to do before. And I think in the most fundamental sense that the CrossFit lesson will be, I think what we're going to be able to show everyone eventually, is that GPP has been much, much neglected in athletic preparation, radically so. Even the notion that I can improve it for 10 years falls outside of most people's athletic experience. Did I answer that? Yeah, thanks.